language pathology's perspective. So I thank sir for the brief introduction. So let us get into the topic. Looking into the operational definition of voice, it can be defined as the outcome of laryngeal modifications, the pulmonary airstream further modified by the vocal tract. So vocal tract represents the length from the level of glottis till the end of the vocal cavity, that is our lip. So the modifications of this airstream results in the production of voice. And we know that the production of voice is a much complex process. It is just not the peripheral phenomenon happening. So it is much complicated, requires the integrated functions of various subsystems along with the central nervous system. And there is a role of cognitive system as well as when we produce voice. So, and there is involvement of subcortical structures so with the proof that even emotions can influence our voice production. That is the operational definition of voice. But when it comes to defining a normal voice, most of us are in confusion, or most of the time we will be in confusion. What I perceive as normal may not be perceived as normal by another speech and language pathologist or another professional who deals with the voice conditions. So to make it easier and to make it clear, so there are certain features that we need to look for to label a voice as normal. A voice could be normal if the quality of voice is clear, and a quality determines the normalcy. A voice could be normal only when it is appropriate for the age, gender, and the situation, the person with respect to his or her occupation, the needs. And a voice could be normal when it is produced without the undue extra effort, be it physical effort or the mental effort. The voice should be produced without any stress or fatigue. So these four domains can be considered to define the normalcy of a voice. So whenever there is a deviation of these four, in vocal dysfunction. Vocal dysfunction is technically called as dysphonia, which can be defined as an impairment of three terminologies, that is pitch, loudness, and quality. Recently, there has been a new term to qualify, to define the voice parameter, that is timbre. So we don't have only three parameters now. We have added parameter is called timbre. Understanding the normalcy and understanding the deviancy, somewhere with the prevalence of these dysphonic conditions, there is requirement for the comprehensive assessment of these parameters from speech and language pathologist perspective. The comprehensive assessment of voice includes acoustic measurement, perceptual evaluation, and aerodynamic assessment. So it's a battery of tests, and we use the test battery approach for evaluation of voice. So carrying out one measurement may not give us the clear picture. And when it comes to these evaluation methods, the acoustic analysis being more objective, that will help us for the quantification of our quantification of a disease or the disordered condition of the vocal pathologies. So that is more reliable, it is more say valid, and it gives us, or it helps us to quantify these vocal pathologies. So that is of our interest. With that, let us get into the acoustic analysis of voice. Acoustic analysis, being an objective measure with the minimal invasive protocol, so becomes our interest here. The rest of the slides here contains information on the acoustic analysis, the definition, the methods we use to determine or to derive the acoustic parameters. And later upon in the slides, we are going to understand how these derived acoustical parameters are significant with respect to day-to-day clinical evaluations. Basically, acoustic analysis involves extraction of these desired parameters from a vocal signal. If a person comes with the voice complaints, other problems with the production of voice, we usually record the voice in digital form. So we use various digital recorders to record the signal, and the recording would be happening in the analog mode. These signals gets converted into digital forms and further will be processed using the digital signal processing technology. And using the digital signal processing technology, we derive these acoustic parameters. Various algorithms have been applied. The algorithms includes inverse filtering, fast Fourier transformer, linear predictive coding. So I'm not going in depth of these algorithms that the acoustic engineers designed to extract parameters from a vocal signal. So I was talking about the procedure involved in that. We're going to the next slide. The procedure of recording and analyzing these voice samples requires significantly sophisticated instrumentation. Then we need to have a sophisticated instrumentation for recording these signals and having to process these digital signal parameters. So the most commonly used softwares and instruments includes what have been listed here. So the most commonly used among speech language pathologists and voice pathologists and some of the professionals involved in main professionals, the ENTs involved in, are they usually use this PRAT software. So it's a free platform software where we all can download it to our own personal computers, and it has few specification. Most of the engineers uploads their algorithms, and there are ready-made algorithms that we can download and put it in our system and use it for analyzing the voice parameters. In Indian scenario, the most commonly used voice evaluation software includes WOGMI. And the WOGMI, basically from the WOGMI diagnostic module, VSS, WOGMI speech systems. Basically, it was designed by Dr. Anantha Padmanabha, an engineer, basically, and a great teacher also. We had got opportunity to interact with him. This software, basically the WOGMI diagnostic, WOGMI speech systems, comes with two modules. One is the diagnostic module and another one is the therapeutic module. So under diagnostic module, we have various options to evaluate the acoustic parameters along with the say aerodynamic parameters as well. So here is a picture how the WOGMI system would look like. So there is an hardware interface, and there is a microphone. Usually when we do the recording of voice samples, always we have to keep in mind that we should use a high definition microphone. Specifically or preferably, we need to have condenser microphone. So a condenser microphone will have a good frequency response. It can detect subtle intensity changes and subtle frequency changes. So whenever we record any voice samples, so most of the time what we tend to do is we record on the mobile microphones or any other microphones that we get, but it may not accurately pick up the say certain vocal pathologies. So in order to have good sensitivity of the microphone matters a lot. So for that we use condenser microphone, and there is a hardware interface which will have a preamplifier. So in this diagram, you can see, in this picture, you can see the WOGMI system comes with the nasometer built in. So it has an option of nasometry as well. So, and the cost of this equipment is around, in our department, and it has come around 4 lakhs. So depending upon the modules that we extend, the add-ons that we do, the price of this software also changes. It is good because it has been based on the Indian population. So I remember we had collaboration with Dr. Anantha Padmanabha in Bangalore. So where we had the opportunity to learn the way they train this database to detect a normal voice from the pathological voice using artificial neural networks. So a screen of that Wagner diagnostic model would look similar to this. It has an option of analyzing the acoustic parameters, both for the phonation sample as well as the speech sample. When it comes to the recording part, the distance between the patients or the speaker's mouth and the microphone matters a lot. So the recommended distance is around 10 to 12 centimeter from the microphone. So if the patient moves away from the microphone, the parameters might not get detected. And if the patient is very closer to the microphone, there could be a distortion of the signal that has been recorded from the voice analysis. So always we need to remember the voice samples that we record should be recorded in appropriate distance so that we reduce the unwanted signals from the acoustic analysis. And there are a lot of controversial or maybe debatable concepts with respect to whether the voice recording samples should be recorded in a sitting position or a standing position. So however, it is not clear but not established, and it is preferable to have a patient in standing position so that it includes it gives us the information with respect to the coordination of respiratory as well as the phonatory system. However, considering the patient's requirement, we go for the sitting position. So in this right picture, you can see the setup of the Wagner system. It's a clinician over. This picture shows another say instrument that we have in our system, in our institute. This is multidimensional voice profile from CSL, computerized speech lab, from Cape Pentax. So this is considered to be the current the most standard equipment that we use for the voice analysis. This instrument comes along with other software modules, including voice range profile. Then it has a motor speech profile, which we can use on patients with motor speech disorders like apraxia, dysarthria, and neurogenic induced communication disorders. All those can be evaluated using this system. The cost of this equipment is around 25 to 27 lakhs, depending upon the number of software add-ons that we are going to take up in this. We have got option of recording two channel and one channel in this. So preferably we record the stereo samples over here. So I'm going to play the video of how do we exactly record and analyze the later part. So for time being, let us understand. So most of these equipments are sophisticated, and the inbuilt mechanism, I mean, the hardware and the algorithms that they use, based on these, the price varies. And most commonly preferred one is that free platform or the software that is Pratt. And in addition to that, we have some softwares called Speech Filling System from UCL, University College of London, their phonetic sciences lab. They have offered a lot of softwares for this digital recording and analysis of voice parameters. They have got a speech filling system, real-time spectrogram, and real-time pitch measures, etc. So that was about the instrumentation part, how we are going to do, or what are the equipments that we are going to use to record the samples and analyze acoustic parameters. So let us see the video. I'm going to share another screen from here. Is the screen visible now?
Yeah, it's starting. Yes, yes.
So when we open the software, a platform, it would look similar to this. So we have CSL, main icon here. The CSL model 400, this is the version, and followed by, when we click on that, we have multiple software platforms here. So I just wanted to bring your attention to the newly designed parameter, that is automatic say dysphonic severity calculations. Earlier it was not there. Recently they have developed this concept of dysphonia severity index that is much more exciting to understand and learn. So before that, we are going to see how a multidimensional voice profile can be used for recording voice samples. So when you open the signal and the software, this screen would appear. So in this, we will go for the recording of new sample, or we can analyze the earlier recorded samples. So when it comes to recording of sample, the preferable length, we need to have adequate length of the sample. So suppose in most of the severe breathy voice cases or severe hoarse conditions or severe vocal pathologies, we may not get the voice samples of that. So we need to have minimum of 3 milliseconds of sample to establish these acoustic parameters. So the duration voicing matters a lot when we extract these parameters. And when it comes to the recording of speech signal, there is a concept of sampling frequency. Sampling frequency will be kept around 44,000. So either we can keep it at low or keep it at high. So when we keep it at high, sample size, it can affect the storing capacity of our systems. And when we keep the lower sampling frequency, that is the conversion of this analog signal to the digital signals, so that can affect the representation of the original signal when we convert this to digital signal. So preferable to have somewhere in the moderate level of sampling frequency. Once we are done with the recording, we need to instruct the patient to sit back, take a deep breath. While breathing out, he has to continuously say ah, the phoneme ah, as long as he can produce, and the set length of the duration, the frame, would be obtained. Later we analyze for the parameters. So this is the recorded sample. You can edit the usually what we do is represents the offset of voicing. So somewhere while setting to the vocal fold motion, I mean while setting into the motion, the vocal folds will have stability. They may not be stable. So to avoid those variations because of this instability in the setting of motion, we usually trim out the initial and the end part. Then we take up the stable portions for analysis. So that is analyzing the sample. Once we analyze, so there appears different windows here. So you can see here, it gives parameters related to fundamental frequency, parameters related to other acoustic derivatives. I'm going to tell in brief about all those parameters in the following slides. So we just have to remember, so this is the analysis window. And in this MDVP, it's a much sophisticated instrument, and it gives the more number of acoustic parameters. It gives us almost like 33 parameters compared to any other software. Our WAGMI software gives around 26 parameter, and Pratt software gives around 22 acoustic derivatives or acoustic. So later we would be doing analysis part of this sample. You can see here. So I'll be sharing the presentation slide. So in brief, we saw how we are going to set up the recording systems, and how we analyze and how we derive the acoustic parameters. So on a net, in a broad way, all the parameters, be it any software or instrument, can be grouped under 7 parameters. So the 7 parameters includes fundamental frequency related parameters, intensity related parameters, then it includes parameters related to the perturbation, then it includes parameters related to the noise component in the vocal signal, and it also relates to the signal related parameters. So on a broad way, all these parameters can be grouped into 5 to 7 categories. I have not highlighted all the parameters here or their definition. So I have taken up only those parameters which have been much reported in the literature and which have been found to be significant with respect to understanding the vocal or voice pathologies. So the first parameter, the group of parameters are fundamental frequency. So fundamental frequency is nothing but the number of times the vocal force comes to midline and goes to the lateral part. So it represents the closing and opening of vocal fold in 1 second. So preferably the terminologies of this fundamental frequency is also called as pitch. So pitch is the correlate of this fundamental frequency. And as I told, it reflects the rate at which the vocal folds vibrate and is measured in hertz. Accordingly, so different categories of population, say adult male, adult female, or adult or infants, they have a particular number of times the vocal folds comes to midline and goes back in 1 second. So here is a normative range for adult male. It is around 80 to 180 hertz. That means to say, in adult males, the vocal force comes to midline and goes back to the lateral part almost like 80 to 180 times in 1 second. So that is what the fundamental frequency is about. So we, all of us, have our own fundamental frequencies. Whenever you get opportunity, you need to get evaluated your own fundamental frequency or your own pitch. This becomes significant with respect to understanding various voice disorder conditions. So in adult females, it is around 180 to 280, and infants, it is around 250 to 650 hertz. Just one more thing to add here. Most of the derivatives are acoustic parameters that we have, almost like 33 parameters. They are all the derivatives based on the fundamental frequency. The major, say, demerit with all this acoustic analysis is that most of the parameters are extracted from establishing fundamental frequency at first. If you are not able to establish the fundamental frequency for a voice signal that you recorded, then none of the parameters gets derived. So the algorithms designed works in such a way that first there will be establishment of fundamental frequency, then the later parameters related to the intensity, the parameters related to the jitter, the perturbation measures, or noise-related or signal-related parameters can be established. So I was talking about the fundamental frequency. Fundamental frequency can vary when we just phonate or just say a continuous sample of R, or it can vary when we speak in sentences. The most preferred measurement of fundamental frequency would be for the narration or reading of this rainbow passage and eliciting this fundamental frequency. So for a running speech, our speaking fundamental frequency is around 265 for children, then 225 for female, and 128. Most of these parameters are to the say Western context. However, a lot of studies have been taken in Indian context to establish the normative data for Indian population, and almost they fit into the same range what the Western population have got. So the fundamental frequency, interestingly, varies with the activities of these muscles. So we have this thyroarytenoid, cricothyroid. These adductor muscles have a significant role in variation of mental frequency. So when I speak in a particular tone, when I vary the tone, I need to change my fundamental frequency. So the fundamental frequency will vary with respect to the muscles activity. Those are the intrinsic muscles of larynx. Those can significantly influence a pitch changing mechanism. So then there are parameters related to variation of this fundamental frequency. So I'm not going in detail about those. The next significant parameter that we derive are related to the intensity. And intensity and amplitude are the interchangeably used words, and represents the pressure level. And when it is expressed in power, it becomes intensity. And when it is represented in, say, sound pressure levels, it is the amplitude. They're usually used interchangeably. Intensity is the rate at which the acoustic energy is transmitted through the surface of a unit or area. So the vocal force, when they obstruct at the level of glottis, and the force with which the particles move from the subglottic area to the glottic area and to the supraglottic area. So the rate at which the transmission happens denotes what we call the intensity. There are various parameters that can change the intensity of the voice signal. The main determining factor for changing of this intensity is the subglottic pressure. So remember, for the vocal pathology, I mean, for the changing of pitch or the fundamental frequency, it was the role of muscles. Here also, there is a role of muscle. However, two factors are important. One is the elastic property of the vocal force, that is recoiling abilities, that is neuromuscular functions. Then the second one is subglottic pressure. So our intensity, the way the audibility of my voice, the intensity or loudness of my voice is determined by the elastic properties of the vocal force and the subglottic pressure. So whenever there is variation of the subglottic pressure, there is change in intensity. So there is a high correlation of these recordings, the acoustic signals that we get. It highly correlates with any variation of this subglottic pressure induced changes in the intensity. And most of the time we get the patients mainly with either change the voice, increase their voice or decrease their voice, and their voice will be monotonous. So the vocal pathologies represents this problem with the loudness or intensity. And there are other parameters which are derived, so I'm not going in detail about those. Various parameters are there based on the intensity. We have minimum intensity, maximum intensity, then intensity range, and intensity when it comes to here I have represented this graphical thing to just to give you an idea what happens in case of people, especially the professional voice users, maybe the singers. They have ability to change the intensity or change the loudness of their voice. So we have these singers keeping the pitch box, we call Shruti box, or Shruti. So they set their fundamental frequency to one level and they can vary their tones, like it can be in semi, by keeping the intensity at steady level or at the same level. So separate variation of intensity and pitch. Somewhere there, the intensity or parameters matters a lot. So in order to be more audible, more authentic, to have more authentic voice, a professional singer need to have this ability to vary the intensity and vary the pitch separately. So those are the illustrations for that. Respect to the transmission, there are normative values for the intensity parameters. So usually children with the age range of 6 to 10 will have a mean value of 70 dB. That is the normal say intensity range for my voice or children's voice. And for adult voice, it is around 70 or 68. And the range will vary from 60 to 110 dB. At currently what I'm speaking in front of say microphone would be around 50 to 60 dB. So that is a normative range for this intensity, and various studies have been carried out to establish this normative. There are age-related changes. We need to, when we correlate these finding or acoustic findings with the condition of the patients, which patients whom we evaluate. So I was talking about the importance of this vocal intensity, and I was telling the intensity usually would be higher in hyperfunctional voice disorder conditions. And most of these structural conditions are structural pathologies. Vocal pathologies related to the structural change will have impact on the production of or variation of this intensity. Hyperfunctional voice disorders, including vocal nodule or muscle tension dysphonia, will have higher intensities. When the person speaks, he tends to speak at higher intensities, and it will worsen the condition of this voice disease or disorder. So other parameters are there. Let me go into those details, not required right now this platform, so I'm just skipping those. The next parameter, so we saw fundamental frequency, then we saw the intensity related parameters, then we have something called perturbation measures. So very significant when we understand the literature, when we do research. The subtle changes with respect to the vocal fold mechanism and the physiology are correlated well with these perturbation measures. So you just imagine for one cycle, there is movement of vocal from vocal fold from the lateral median side to the midline, and they again go back to the lateral side. So when they come to midline and go back in one cycle, there would be say variations with respect to the vocal folds movement coming to the midline and going back. So there will be horizontal variations, there could be vertical variations of the vocal fold because of the mucosal wave which is present. So the acoustic parameters which are responsive to these changes, say for example, the mucosal wave on vocal folds, if it gets drained, so that can affect or that can be well correlated with these perturbation measures. So we have perturbation measures which are significant for our day-to-day clinical interpretations. So major parameters are jitter and shimmer. So cycle-to-cycle variation, that is coming to the midline and going back to the lateral side. So it will in one cycle, variation with respect to the frequency, we call it as jitter, and variation with respect to the loudness or amplitude, we call it as shimmer. So there are various derivatives within jitter and shimmer. So multidimensional voice profile gives in detail about extracted parameters based on jitter and shimmer. So just to just a view on these perturbation measures. So most of the medications, especially the pre and post medication conditions, have been documenting these perturbation measures. I mean, these perturbation measures gives us a real quantum of these changes with respect to the medication or with respect to the surgical interventions which have been done by our surgeons. So it's a good tool to compare the pre and post conditions with respect to medicines or any therapeutic intervention, or it could be chemotherapy or medications. And these are the derivatives of those. We need not worry much about these. We need to look for these parameters whenever we get the voice report. So in OPD, when the person gets evaluated for this acoustic parameter, somewhere we need to look for this jitter related parameters and shimmer related parameters. So we just need to know the normative range. So the next domain of parameters that we are going to obtain or derive are noise related parameter measures. So we have various derivatives: harmonics to noise ratio, number of harmonics, normalized noise ratio, signal to noise ratio, harmonic to noise ratio, etc. One thing that I want all of us to understand here is that though we have so many parameters, we need to understand the, how it is related to the physiology of the vocal fold mechanism. Most of these noise related parameters gives us an indication regarding the excitation patterns of vocal folds. So what happens when a person phonates? While phonating, there would be a particular pattern of vocal fold movement compared to when the person is phonating with the disordered condition, or it could be the regular breathing during the respiratory cycles or breathing pattern compared to the conditions of voicing. The excitation pattern of the vocal folds varies. So the relative excitation pattern of these vocal folds are the mucosal waves on the vocal folds and the different layers of the vocal folds represents these noise related parameters. So noise related and signal related parameters are the quantum of these variations of vocal fold excitation during the actual voicing and during the pathological voicing, or it could be the regular breathing. So accordingly, we have various parameters. One parameter that you need to look for is harmonics to noise ratio. Significantly, it has been studied across the vocal pathological conditions, and it gives us the sound pressure level of harmonics versus sound pressure level of corresponding noise. So when the sound or the particles travels from the glottic level, from the supraglottic to the oral cavity, so there is dampening of the signal at particular point. The vocal tract, because of the dimensions of the vocal tract, there is resonance happening. So when there are resonances which are related to the fundamental frequency or the movement of the vocal fold conditions, so they are called harmonics. So somewhere we need to look for somewhere we need to look for these parameters. So when it comes to the quantification of harmonics, we have males around 30 to 35 peaks of these harmonics, and as the pathologic conditions varies, there could be absence or there could be reduction of these harmonics. So harmonics represents the vocal quality. I mean, it is correlated with vocal quality. So I'm just skipping these slides. The concept which I have explained has been put in the slides here. I wanted to draw your attention to the new derivative or the parameter that we have got. It is dysphonia severity index. So it is a derivative of acoustic derivatives, means we have obtained certain parameters from that. Again, we have say modulated and we have quantified a new parameter called dysphonia severity index. It mainly consists of the recordings of MPT, maximum phonation time, with the high F0 fundamental frequency, highest fundamental and lowest intensity jittering percentage. Using these four derivatives and particular formula, these authors in the year 2000 have given this concept of dysphonia severity index. It works good, very well, I mean, well with our clinical signs and symptoms. It correlates well with the various pathological conditions. Somewhere we need a lot of research on larger population in India to establish normatives for this BSI parameter. So we don't have such normative for currently. There are established for particular regions, maybe South Karnataka or. So in a larger sample, there needs a study to be taken up. So DSA values can vary from say 1.8, minus 1.8, 1.8 to minus 4.3. So depending upon the severity of the conditions, parameters varies. I mean, depending upon the condition, the values varies. So it's a good quantification parameter. So with that, we have concluded the various acoustic parameters and their derivatives. So the next thing would be the interesting thing, that how these parameters are correlated with various pathological conditions. So this would be much interesting than these acoustic derivatives. They are more of technical terms related to the acoustic, acoustic phonetics. Let us take up these clinical conditions, what happens. So most of these voice disorder conditions, they come with either primary phonatory feature or secondary phonatory features. Primary phonatory features are related to if the vocal folds are inadequately adapted, it's because of the improper closing of vocal folds, and forms the primary feature of voice. To compensate that, a person with voice disorder might develop compensatory mechanism, thereby developing the secondary phonatory features. Mainly it includes the quality such as the roughness, which could be a outcome of the poor adapted vocal fold. So when a person comes, he will have primary features and secondary phonatory features. We need to look for those. The major symptoms of the voice disorder, which we come across in clinical day-to-day clinical activities, includes this hoarseness, vocal fatigue, breathy voice, reduced phonation range, aphonia, then pitch breaks, then strained voice or tremor. Next conditions which have been reported are like vocal nodule forms, waste form. One thing that I want to tell here is all these eight major symptoms what have been reported by the patients with voice problem are, I mean, they have significant correlated acoustic parameter. So if, for example, a person who comes with a hoarseness, he has set of, say, parameters, acoustic parameters. A person who comes with the breathy voice, he has set of a featured characteristics of these acoustic parameters. A person who comes without any voicing, only minimal voicing within the vocal fold pathology, maybe like vocal fold paralysis condition, will have set of parameters. So it is interesting to correlate these and have a thoughtful sight before interpreting the patient's conditions. And just to remember, so these voice disorder conditions are always, say, ambiguous, means they are always confusing. What I perceive, what one person as a professional decides whether it's a normal voice or pathological voice, the other person might get diagnosed as normal voice. So it always varies with the examiners. In order to reduce those misdiagnosis or say poor correlation, So somewhere we need to have this objectification for these eight major symptoms. So that is the effort that acoustic analysis will be doing. Yeah, let us understand what happens in case of vocal fold excessively, if they're held tight. So the fundamental frequency will be higher. So in case of vocal fold thickness or shorter, so they will have reduced, say, in case of vocal fold tension being unstable, they do have problem with the stability of this fundamental frequency. There could be pitch breaks, that. So in case the insufficient vocal fold adjustment, they will have restricted to upper or lower frequency informations. If the vocal fold is short and thick with increased mass or increased vocal fold tension, look for the fundamental frequency related or the pitch range informations. And the intermittent or excessive lengthening or shortcoming, this can be seen in most of the spasmodic dysphonia conditions. So somewhere this pitch range information, the derivatives of this fundamental frequency with respect to variation of fundamental frequency can give us the underlying pathological conditions. If there is excessive glottic air pressure, it might result in increased loudness of voice. And if there is insufficient, and if there is glottic chink, that will result in softness of the voice. Then if the vocal folds, false vocal folds involves in vibration, that will result in rough voice. Similarly, if the airflow is not smooth, results in turbulent, that will result in breathy voice. If the vocal folds are hyperadducted, that will result in creaky voice. And if the intermittent or incomplete vocal folds, say adduction happens, then there will be voiceless segment in the voice samples. So similarly, you can look for the correlation of this vocal stamina. So here are the slides of different pathologies which are grouped under these categories. Like we have structural, neurogenic, sorry, systemic, meningeal, and disorder of voice use and airway dysfunction, all these. So the underlying conditions could be any of these. So the studies, the day-to-day research studies in our department involves quantifying the acoustic parameters for these disorders. So we are we are correlating and we are getting sample base for these different conditions, and we are trying to make a point out of these acoustic parameters for these underlying conditions. A lot of studies have been taken up with respect to the disorder of voice pitch, mainly the muscle tension dysphonia. We have got the highest referral from the conditions of muscle tension dysphonia type 1 and type 2. Most of them are hyperfunctional voice disorders, mainly seen in teachers and say professional voice users, mainly vocal abuse and misuse. And in order to understand these acoustic parameters and the derivatives, I have put here analysis report of a normal voice. So the voice here, however, that is not getting played here. So I add a sample of normal male voice, and the diagram here is representing the vocal parameters that we have extracted. The green color represents the normalcy, that is what is being understood, and there would be set of parameters which can be deviant from in a obtained signal. Means when you record a signal and when you analyze for the parameters, so if the parameters are deviant compared to the database or the samples that we compare with the stored base, so there could be deviation happening with respect to certain features. So that will be shown. So this is a normal male voice. You can see the fundamental frequency range. We have a normative value and it is the obtained value. Most of the time we need to compare these parameters with the normative data which has been given with the instrumentation. So we have almost 33 parameters in this. In the right side of the screen, you can see the MDVP report or the voice report. You have 33 parameters. And I had included a few parameters which have been significantly reported in the literature, which are significant alerts for the vocal pathologies. Then this was for the female voice. I'm not able to play the voice clip here. So here you can see the average fundamental frequency of 233 against the normative range of 243. So remember, your acoustic parameters varies across the ages, across the gender, and somewhere we need to compare accordingly. Like a child's voice should be fetal data. Similarly, for a female and for male, so accordingly we have to compare with the normatives. So in case of bilateral vocal nodule, so what could be the acoustic parameters finding? So you can see here, the fundamental frequency of their speech, or speaking fundamental frequency, will be reduced because of the presence of these mass on the vocal folds. So they are typically the result of vocal misuse and abuse behaviors. So acoustic parameters are correlated well with the perturbation measures, that is mainly the jitter and shimmer. Whenever you get a patient with vocal nodule, look for these parameters of speaking fundamental frequency, the jitter and shimmer, and of course they are well correlated with the perceptual parameters. We have not taken up that concept over here. So just to have equivalent, say when we interpret, we need to look for the acoustic parameters along with the perceptual and along with the aerodynamic. Somewhere the correlation has to be made. All these comprehensive assessed. So MDVP. The medical here indicate the obtained signal. So it need not be abnormal voice, it need not be pathological voice. What it indicates is that in the example you analyze, these are related to the clinical. Similarly, I had a voice here. I had a voice sample over here, but I am not able to play that here. In case of severe hoarse voice, the major parameters which are affected includes the signal to noise related parameters. You can see here in the right part. So the parameters related to noise to harmonic ratio, voice turbulence index, soft phonation index, all this could be deviant. You can see here, so amplitude tremor intensity index is around 9.940, whereas the normative is around 2.13. So the deviations will happen with respect to this noise and signal related components in case of hoarse voice. So fundamental frequency might not be much affected here. However, the related parameters and noise components, or noise to signal ratio or signal harmonics, can be affected. So for a severe hoarse voice condition, you can see the red color for jitter, jit, rap, EPQ and SPQQ. So these are nothing but the acoustic parameters which are significantly deviant in the recorded voice sample. So let us take the example of sulcus vocalis. Most of the time, the most misdiagnosed condition in our routine practices are sulcus vocalis. So we call it as, most of the time we don't know what is the condition of, what is the cause for this glottic chink. So when they evaluate most of these glottic chink cases, even though when they appear normal on a regular, say invasive examinations, however, when it comes to the functioning, so we can make out. So sulcus vocalis draws significant attention from these rehabilitation professionals. So we have various acoustic parameters where the perturbation measures are correlated with the findings. Especially the noise related parameters might be like within normal, however, the perturbation measures would be affected. Then there would be reduction in the phonation range among them, and there would be reduction of phonation times. So here is a diagram of typical case of sulcus vocalis. So you can see here various parameters which are deviant in the sample. Our next interesting thing, our clinical condition, is vocal fold paralysis condition. We know it could be the unilateral condition or it could be bilateral condition. In our clinic, most of the time we get left vocal fold paralysis condition with the various cardiac issues. And in case of vocal fold paralysis, there could be increased components of this breathiness, which correlates with the increased aperiodicity and increased noise levels. All the acoustic parameters which are related to this noise component in the acoustic parameters are significantly affected in case of vocal fold paralysis condition. And obviously there will be reduced maximum phonation time because of the glottic chink or the condition. So here was a example or sample video, audio clip of this breathy voice. So for a breathy voice that we have got, so here are the acoustic parameters on the right part of the screen. You can see there, For the brightness, you can see much correlated parameters are NHR, then PPQs, then APQs, then shimmer and jitter, then PPQs with S. The number of say voiced and unvoiced components, and voice turbulence index is looking like in this condition. Another clinical condition that we come up regularly, piburphonia. So in piburphonia, the age-related changes with respect to mass, length, and tension of the vocal folds would be varying among pubertal male boys. There would be variation with respect to fundamental frequency. Sometimes they will have normal pitch, like an adult. Sometimes they would be going back to the pitch of a child. So it is also correlated well and documented using acoustic parameter. You can see eye pitch and pitch breaks, increased F naught variation, increased jitter and shimmer in these conditions. And the perceptual correlation is well, say correlated with this. Perceptual parameters are well correlated with these acoustic parameters. So here was a sample with the variation of fundamental frequency. There was a significant change in the fundamental frequency. So according, you can see here, the related jitter and shimmer parameters varying consistently. And the last condition here is the spasmodic dysphonia. Here, it could be abductor or adductor dysphonic condition. Spasmodic dysphonia could be of abductor or adductor type. Accordingly, the parameters will change, and the perceptual main correlate of this condition is strain and strangulated voice. So we increased perturbation variations. So the frequency can be definitely affected with this, and variation of this frequency or fundamental frequency related informations varies, and much correlated with these perceptual parameters, and of course significantly affected in this spasmodic dysphonic condition. When it comes to the differential diagnosis of abductor and adductor dysphonia, the acoustic parameters give significant input for the differential diagnosis in the clinical examination procedures. So that's about various clinical conditions and their correlations with the acoustic parameters. The last thing that I wanted to highlight here was on voice range profile or phonetogram. We keep coming across this. Voice range indication, it could be the graphical representation, or it could be the quantum or quantification using the numbers. It gives to vary the voice from lowest to highest with respect to the pitch and the intensity. So generally what we do, we give them a set of base pitch. Note over here, we set the base pitch, we make the person to glide the phonation of R from lower intensity, from lower pitch to higher intensity and higher pitch. So accordingly, we record and analyze, we obtain these parameters. So we note the minimum fundamental frequency that they have got and maximum fundamental frequency that they could reach through this gliding process. And we obtain the intensity across these. So the graphical representation of this ability of a person to vary the pitch and intensity from minimum to maximum is what we call as phonetogram. And recently, a lot of attention from the voice researchers, and a lot of studies have this VRP. Understanding this VRP is an interesting thing. So the singers, especially trained classical singers, they have the ability of varying their pitch from the bass pitch up to 2 to 3 octaves, like down and up, based on their musical notes. So all those quantification, when they come to us as a say for their voice therapy, most of the time age related changes might happen for these background singers or the professional voice users who are basically the singers. When they come to us, we need to have certain say evaluating or instrumentation to evaluate their voice. So VRP is a tool to evaluate these professional voice users' abilities, and it gives larger the area of this phonetogram indicates the higher integrity of these functions, their ability to sustained phonation for different ranges. So affected VRP or reduced area in the phonetogram indicates the vocal pathologies. So with that, I conclude my small talk on these acoustic parameters and their derivatives, how they are correlated in day-to-day clinical conditions in our, say, routine clinical exam of these voice pathologies. Thank you. I'm open for taking the questions. Any questions?
Thank you, sir. That was a very candid speech on voice modulations and voice parameters. So I would open up the question and answer session for the audience. Yeah, you can just unmute yourself and interact. Any questions from the audience? So one question, hand-free microphone versus head-mounted microphone.
Hand-free microphone versus head-mounted microphone. Preferable to hand-free microphone, and I'm not sure about the frequency response. When we go for selection of these microphones, we need to look for the frequency response. Whenever we purchase any microphone, the back part of that, like, they would mention the frequency range of that particular microphone. So we need to look for the frequency range, whether it is from 50 hertz to say 8 kilohertz, or whether it is sensitive enough for the low frequency and can go up to 15 kilohertz. Most of our speech range is within 5 to 6 kilohertz. Means all the speech sounds that we speak, when put under say frequency analysis, all the sounds might appear within these 5 to 6 kilohertz. However, certain vocal condition, vocal pathologies will be of higher say frequency ranges. So somewhere we need to have proper frequency response microphone. It can be say head mounted or hand free, but look for a condenser type microphone and preferably with a better frequency response.
VROM and VDOP.
Yeah, that was interesting question. There are no clear cut standard marks for this differentiation of abductor versus adductor spasmodic dysphonia. Certain features related to the perturbation measures and the presence of these harmonics, that would give insight for better differential diagnosis. Mainly we look for the number of harmonics, or it could be done through the Kestrel analysis. We have the spectral analysis, the reverse of that spectral Kestrel analysis, and the number of harmonics that we calculate can help us and give us an idea about whether it is related to abductor or adductor spasmodic dysphonia. However, it is a close call. Hence, there are no like extreme contrast between these in acoustic parameters, and depends on which frame that I select and analyzing the voice sample. So if I select particular say 30 frames and analyze for that, I mean, if I apply that are derived will be different. The moment I change the frame and analyze in the next, say, 10 milliseconds frame. So it varies a lot. However, significantly, the number of harmonics help. The audio is not clear. Can you repeat, sir?
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Tell me, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's audible now.
Yeah. So the last question was, I answered the question.
Yes.
Can you explain PROM and VDOP? I hope you have answered that.
No, sir, that was not clear. That question was not clear. What is PROM or VDOP? Which context? I was not sure about that question. Can the person speak and ask that question? What exactly they wanted to know?
Clarify what you are asking.
When it comes to self-evaluation of voice, we have various rating scales. Mainly, we use the standardized rating scale, currently being the VHI, Voice Handicap Index, is what most preferred one. Not sure about this PROM and VDOP. Maybe I need to explore more on that. I can comment about it. Not sure about self-evaluation tools.
Any more questions from the audience? Yeah, I think that is the end of the Q&A session.
Yeah, just to engage the audience, I was talking about three platforms provided by the Phonetic Science Lab of UCL. So they have done a lot of experiments, and when it comes to the analysis or establishment of these instruments or standardization of their equipments, the most preferred destination is India, because we have variant say population. There is all the instrumentation, their standardizations are done. Do here, goes good. And we all can install those freely available softwares and try to say record and see parameters. Yeah, there is a question on can you explain DSI? Okay. So, dysphonia severity index is a new derivative. It's a recent, maybe it's a derivative or invention. So it combines the already existed acoustic parameters, mainly the maximum phonation time, then we have highest intensity, highest fundamental frequency and lowest intensity, and using these parameters. So remember, your intensity gives information or insights into the role of respiratory system. The highest fundamental frequency gives an insight onto the intact of this laryngeal system. Then maximum phonation time uses the insight or the valuable information about the coordination happening between respiratory system and the phonatory system. So you need to have adequate, say, breath support for production of appropriate duration of voicing. So DSI somewhere makes an attempt to quantify all this together. Parameters works good with the perceptual evaluation. So for example, a person with deadly voice, the DSI findings are correlated with them, with say affected the parameter of this intensity. The person with say vocal fold palsy, they have correlations with the reduced MPT. So accordingly, the values have been given DSI in the range of say 1.8 to minus 4.3. That we can group the patients based on the DSI values they have got, able to severely dysphonic or minimal to normal. So it is a quantification of this dysphonia, basically using these four acoustic parameters. Yeah, the next question is, sir, explain any relationship between GRD and LGRD. For my knowledge, I think the conditions are, words are interchangeable. Not sure about, you mean to say the acoustic findings in GRD and LPRD or the relationship between GRD and LPRD? You mean findings of acoustics in GRD condition? Psychogenic voice disorders, interesting question. In psychogenic voice disorders, the acoustic battery or the acoustic parameters are not reliable. We does not depend only on the measurements of these acoustic parameters. Somewhere we need to rely upon the perceptual variations, I mean perceptual measurements, and we need to correlate with the acoustic findings. So psychogenic and neurogenic induced voice conditions shows a lot of variability. And in case of psychogenic voice disorders, the significant parameters that we need to look for in acoustic measures are related to the fundamental frequency and intensity derivatives. So most of these noise related and signal related parameters are derivative of the fundamental frequency. So somewhere we need to look for the parameters of this fundamental variance. Purely depending upon the acoustic values may not be the proper diagnosis for the psychogenic and neurogenic induced voice conditions, such as say lateral medullary syndrome conditions where there is dysfunction. Every time you record the sample and analyze, the values varies. And that is that is one of the demerit of these acoustic measures. However, something is better than like at all quantifying them. So that's how we perform this acoustic measurement. So they're better way of quantifying these conditions. Nikhil says thank you. They have speech filling systems, they have real time speech measurements, they have real time spectrograms. So RTSP, that is real time spectrogram, real time speech. Then they have a vocal demo, VT demo. So they have a demonstration of what happens to acoustic phonetics when you vary the vocal tract dimensions. They have VT demo, then there are options of speech filling system, SFS. That would give a lot of information related to the spectrographic. So Pratt being a free platform, we all can say download to our system and use. There are standardized algorithms which are designed and uploaded, world copy. We just have to use those coding and analyze district parameters. So BSI can also be derived out of this Pratt software. However, it has to be done manually. The software developer. I told that speech filling system SFS, PT demo, real time spectrogram, time pitch analysis. It's available in your web. Phonetic science labs are so. So well established. So, all right, if there are no more questions, you would like to.
Yes, sir, I think come to that of your. So, thank you, sir. That was really excellent speech, excellent webinar, and I hope we have all the audience had a great take-home messages today. And we would hope Mr. Hemraja to give us more topics in the future and continue his teaching with us. Thank you. Thank you one and all. Sir, any concluding marks? So can you hear me? Hello?
I think we have lost Hemraja's connection.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I was trying to reconnect with him. Ma'am, any concluding remarks, ma'am?
I think he's done a very good job. He summed up the whole thing in a very simple way for everybody to understand. And I'm sure a lot of postgraduates are here, and many of them take voice related topics for their thesis, whether it is related to micro-laryngeal surgery, benign lesions, or even voice related to the laryngeal laryngectomies and the post-laryngectomy rehab they do. Also, evaluation of voice quality, many of them do. I think this would have been really a good session for them to understand this. And what I would like to tell them is that, you know, the more we start working in tandem with the voice pathologists and start understanding the voice evaluation parameters one by one, only then our understanding of the subject will
I would like to thank
yeah ma'am.
Otherwise we will only be, you know, trying to learn again and again, you know, we'll be only getting small reviews during while attending such webinars or attending a conference or a CMA program. After that, it will be forgotten, irrespective of whether we take up a thesis proposal or any other research project. We need to work in tandem with the voice pathologists and try to see what they are doing, go reports, try to interpret the parameters, and clinically, because they are not directly seeing the clinical picture of the patient. So clinically, we need to correlate whatever we are seeing with the voice parameters that are being analyzed on a day-to-day basis, like how we do. Today, we do a lot of these audiograms we do, but when it comes to voice evaluation and voice analysis parameters, we don't do it. So we need to make it a habit to go through these parameters on a daily basis, and only then we will improve and we'll be able to do the best for our patients. So that is what I would like to see. I think Hemraj did a very good job by making things pretty simple for all of us.
Yes, ma'am. Even I had a very, I mean, a good learning session. Most of it was never taught us during our PG. So it's a new learning experience for me too. So any concluding remarks by the speaker, Mr. Hemraj, can you speak? Are you audible?
Yes, sir. Thank you, ma'am. As a conclusion, a concluding note, I would like to especially thank the organizing committee. So sir has been supportive in all the time, like a lot of technical issues we worked upon. I would like to personally thank my mentor and Professor Dr. Vijayalakshmi ma'am, providing me an opportunity to use this platform to share what the minimal knowledge we had.
Thank you, sir. We hope to have more presentations with us in the future. With this, I would say good night to all the delegates and postgraduate students, and have a good night all.